Welcome back to our online youth conference with the theme, Today is the Day of Salvation. I hope and pray that you have enjoyed all the presentations that have been shared thus far, and that today will be a special conclusion to our wonderful seminar. Before we continue, I would like us to have a word of prayer.
Dear Heavenly Father, we come into your presence to thank for the opportunity to come together as your children and to learn more about your will for our lives. Please be with those that are present, but not only them, as well as their families, and that whatever trouble that may hinder the listening of your message may be put into your hands and trusted to your infinite wisdom. We pray that the messenger will speak your words and that they may find a home in our hearts and life in our actions. Please forgive our sins. In dear Jesus' name, amen.
Today we are going to be presented with the topic, Let the little children come unto me, with the thought, they are important today. Brother Bobby Bell is going to be sharing two presentations with us. The first is going to be for the children and the second is for the parents. I hope that each and every one of us will be attentive to both presentations as it will be sharing valuable information for everyone. I would like us to turn our Bibles to the book of Mark chapter 10, verse 14 and 15. Mark 10, 14 and 15. It says, But when Jesus saw it, he was much displeased and said unto them, Suffer the little children to come unto me and forbid them not. For of such is the kingdom of God. Verily I say unto you, whosoever shall not receive the kingdom of God as a little child shall not enter therein. Amen. Christ spoke these words to rebuke the disciples and to comfort the mothers with their children. But I believe that these words were also spoken to give us an encouragement in these last days to always remember to be like children, having that spirit of true trust and belief, having that faith that our loving Heavenly Father will always be there to welcome us and protect us whenever we have any problems that we are faced with. And as we are talking about salvation today, I believe that that is the most earnest cry that we have to make to our Father in heaven to help us that we will one day be saved. May God bless us as we're going to listen to the wonderful presentation. And may God continue to keep our children in His hands. At this time, I'd like to invite all the children to come closer and pay special attention as Uncle Bobby shares with you a wonderful message.
I'm a pilgrim and I'm a stranger. I can tarry but a night. Do not detain me, for I am going to where the fountains are ever flowing. I'm a pilgrim and I'm a stranger. I can tarry but a night. There the glory is ever shining. Oh, my longing heart is there. Here in this country, so dark and dreary, I long to wander, for lone and weary. I'm a pilgrim and I'm a stranger. I can tarry but a night. There's a city to which I journey. My Redeemer is its light. There is no sorrow, nor any sighing, nor any tears there, nor any dying. I'm a pilgrim, and I'm a stranger. I can tarry but a night.
Hi, boys and girls. I'm so happy you're here. I'm Brother Bobby. Now, some of you might remember me as Uncle Bobby from the Junior Searcher program we had a couple of years ago. And if you do, you know that I love to spend time with kids, and I also enjoy telling stories about Jesus because he's my very best friend. And that's what I want to talk to you about today, Jesus and friendship, and how Jesus wants you to become one of his very best friends too. You know, God created each one of you because he wants you to be his special friend. And not only that, he's the one who put the desire in us so that we'll want to have him as our friend too. He also instilled in us the desire to have friends here on earth. So, do you have a good friend? Or maybe even someone you consider a best friend? Having many friends or even just one special friend is a real blessing. Well, I am very blessed because I do have several people in my life that I consider friends. But I also have one best friend, and his name is Karsten. He lives in Germany. That's way over in Europe. We've been friends for more than 40 years. And even though he lives far away in Europe, and I live here in the United States, and we hardly ever get to see each other face to face, we've still managed to have a very close friendship for all these years. How do you think we do that? Stay so close, that is. Well, we used to write each other letters all the time. And sometimes we still send each other a card or a postcard. I don't know about you, but I still love getting mail from someone. But nowadays, thanks to technology, we text each other, we call, and sometimes we even get to see each other when we use video chat. Of course, the best is when we actually get to visit and spend time together in person. That's whenever I go to Germany or he comes here to Virginia. Unfortunately, that doesn't happen too often. You know, even though we're best friends, almost like brothers, we're both still very different people. But that's a really cool thing about friendship. You don't have to be exactly alike. But usually most friends share something in common that they both enjoy, right? And one thing Karsten and I both have a passion for is being out in nature. Some of you might know that about me already, right? Well, when Karsten and I get together, we love to go on hikes, bicycle trips, and sometimes we even do silly stuff, well, like climbing trees. Yep, that's us this past summer up in a tree. So what about you? Do you have a good friend or a best friend? If you do, how did you become friends? How do you stay friends? What do you like most about your friend? Now let me ask you something else. Has your friend ever disappointed you? Yeah, it happens. Hey, we're all human, right? Even the best of friends can disagree or let each other down sometimes. Well, I've already introduced you to my best human friend, but the person I really want to talk about today is my very best friend. And you know what? He wants to be your very best friend too. He's a friend you'll always want to spend time with. And he'll always want to spend time with you too. He's a friend who's always there when you need him. A friend who'll never let you down. I'm sure some of you know who he is, right? Remember, I told you in the beginning. Yep, you guessed it. It's Jesus. He wants to be your very best friend forever. And honestly, he's the only true BFF, best friend forever, and I mean truly forever. Jesus really loves girls and boys just like you. In fact, did you know that in the Bible, in the New Testament, three of the Gospels, the first four books in the New Testament, give us a short story that shows just how special children are to Jesus? And that's the story I want to share with you today. We'll call this story, Let the Children Come to Me Today. So Jesus had traveled from Galilee to the coast of Judea. And as usual, everywhere that Jesus went, there were a lot of people who had followed him and were crowded around him. There were all kinds of people. Rich people, poor people, young people, old people, people who loved Jesus very much. And sadly enough, there were also people who didn't like him. And they only followed him around hoping to catch Jesus doing something wrong. So all of these people followed Jesus around, but not all for the same reason. Still, most of them were hoping he might soon be the king of the Jews, who would get rid of all the Romans and make life happier for all the Jewish people. The people also loved to listen to him teach and talk about the kingdom of God. Of course, there were many people who had heard how Jesus had healed the sick as well, so they were there hoping that Jesus would heal them. Whole families, moms, dads, kids, grandmas, grandpas, they all came out to see Jesus. Like I said, there were a lot of people who were there to see him for one reason or another. And of course, everybody who was there wanted to get as close as they could to hear what Jesus was saying and maybe even get to meet him personally. But with such a huge crowd of people, their chances weren't that good. But there was one group of people who had a very specific reason for wanting to see Jesus. You see, in the Jewish culture, parents would sometimes bring their children to a rabbi to have the rabbi lay his hands on them and bless them. By the way, a rabbi was basically a person who taught other people about God. And many of the people, even if they didn't understand that Jesus was the Son of God, they did consider him a very special rabbi. So, some mothers who had heard that Jesus was coming decided to take their children to him and ask him to bless them. The idea might have started with just one mom, and perhaps as she was walking through her village on her way to see Jesus, another mom asked her where she was going. When she told them she was taking her kids to be blessed by Jesus, I'm sure other moms thought, well, that's a great idea, and decided to tag along and do the same thing. So all these mothers had brought their children to see Jesus, hoping to have him bless them. I imagine some of them had probably walked a long way to get where Jesus was. Now just think, once they got there, they realized they weren't the only ones who'd come to see Jesus. They weren't the only ones wanting Jesus to do something for them personally. After getting there and seeing all those other people, the moms could have gotten discouraged and figured, oh, it's impossible. But these mothers, they loved their children and they were determined to get to Jesus no matter what and have him bless their kids. So with all those other people there, the moms had to work really hard, working their way through the crowd in order to get to Jesus, but they really wanted to get to him. They had come this far and nothing was going to keep them from getting to Jesus. So they just kept working their way closer and closer until they were almost to Jesus. But you know what happened? Well, Jesus' disciples saw these mothers with their children trying to get to Jesus. And you know what they did? They stopped them. Not only that, but the Bible says that Jesus' disciples rebuked or scolded the moms for even trying to get close to Jesus just to have him bless their kids. Basically, the disciples felt like Jesus was too busy and that Jesus had more important things to do than just spend some time with these mothers and their children. They thought what Jesus was doing was too important for him to stop. Besides, these were just kids, right? How could they understand just how important all this was or how important Jesus was? Now, I'm sure the disciples meant well. They were sincere in trying to protect Jesus and choose who could get close to him. But they were sincerely wrong in what they were doing, and Jesus was about to make that very clear. You see, little did they know that Jesus was watching the whole time. He wanted to see what the disciples would do, and it made him sad that his own disciples were treating these mothers and their children with such unkindness. But you know what Jesus did? The Bible tells us that he told his disciples, "Suffer the little children to come unto me, and forbid them not, for such is the kingdom of God." That's right. Jesus turned around and kind of scolded his disciples, just like they had done to the moms. He let them know, "Don't tell them they can't come to me. Let them come. I want them to come. I'm their friend too. I want my kingdom to be full of kids just like these." And then he took each one of the children into his arms and he laid his hands on them and he blessed them. You know what else Jesus did? Well, when he had one of the little kids on his lap, he told everyone there that if they wanted to be a part of his kingdom, then they needed to become just like this young child. Isn't that awesome? I have a question. Do you think those girls and boys who were blessed by Jesus remembered that day when they got older? Well, I have a feeling that their moms told them that story many times throughout their lives so that they wouldn't forget that special day and just how special they were to Jesus. What an amazing experience. So let me ask you, was Jesus busy that day? Yes. Were there a lot of other people around wanting to get to Jesus? Absolutely. Were there even important people who maybe wanted to talk to Jesus? Probably. Still, Jesus made it clear that he was never too busy to take time for boys and girls just like you. I tell you what, I would have loved to have been one of those kids, wouldn't you? Getting to talk to Jesus personally, getting a hug from Jesus, having him lay his hands on me and bless me. Wouldn't you love to be one of those boys and girls that Jesus said, "Let them come to me"? Well, you know what? You can be one of those kids. When Jesus said, "Let the children come to me," he meant all kids, all children. So even though that was said over 2,000 years ago, he still means you. He wants you to come to him so that he can bless you. He wants to be your best friend today, right now. He wants to spend time with you every day so that you can get to know him even better. And what is really awesome, if you ask Jesus to be your friend, if you ask him to come into your heart, to be part of your life today, then you can hang out with Jesus anytime you want to. Because once you make Jesus your friend, he will never leave your side. He will always be with you, always have time for you, 24/7, guaranteed. So how about it? Would you like to be best friends with Jesus? Well, you can. And you can do it right now, right where you are. And if you do ask Jesus to be your forever friend, it might be nice if you talk to your mom, dad, or someone else who you know knows Jesus, and ask them to pray with you. And while you're at it, ask them to give you some ideas about how you can get to know Jesus better and build a friendship that will last forever. By the way, if you want to, and if it's okay with your parents or guardian, check out the Junior Searcher YouTube channel. You can go to youtube.com/Junior Searcher, and there you'll find 13 lessons about building a forever friendship with Jesus. So check it out if you can. Well, I'm so glad we got to spend this time together today. I hope you enjoyed the story, but most of all, I hope that if you're not already friends with Jesus, that you make the decision to make him your best friend forever today. Remember, Jesus loves you. So do I. God bless you. Have a wonderful day. Bye.
Thank you so much, little ones, for joining us and listening to Uncle Bobby as he shared with you words of encouragement. I hope that you took something to heart and that God will continue to bless you in your life journey. Amen. At this time, we are going to take a short break with two items of music. Thereafter, I would like to invite all the parents to join us again as Brother Bobby Bell is going to share with us the second part of his presentation.
Torrents fall and the flood run deep. There's a
Welcome. I'm very happy that you're taking the time to participate in this seminar, and I feel blessed to have this opportunity to share with you today. You know, oftentimes before a person begins to speak on certain topics, it's important that they offer what is called a qualifier, basically stating what qualifies them to address the topic at hand. In my case, I could tell you that I've been an educator for 30 years almost, as well as working in the mental health field as a counselor for troubled children and youth. So I do have experience working and helping children and families. I'm also a single parent. I raised two adult sons who now live on their own, and I have one teenage son still living at home. But truthfully, the reason I'm here today, believing that I have something to share with you, something to give to you, is because even though I want to offer suggestions, perhaps some counsel, on how, as a parent, you can effectively bring or lead your children to Jesus, I believe that my number one qualifying attribute is the fact that I am a very good example of what not to do. You see, as well-intended as I was, most of the things I did to try to make my boys good little Adventists were the very things that drove them away. So, you know, I know from experience what does not work. I focused on all the externals. They knew how to look, how to act, how to eat, etc. They knew all the rules. And all the time, I never won their hearts for Jesus. And sadly, my experience in the church over the years has been that most of these same mistakes are being made by many of our parents still today, and regrettably with the same results. Because the fact is, our children are leaving the faith that we hold so dear. But in my opinion, what is possibly even more disturbing is that many of our children and young people, even though they continue to live under our roofs, participate in all the church activities, go through all the outward motions of being good little Adventist reformers, the reality is they're already mentally, spiritually, and emotionally gone. And we don't even recognize it. So today, I hope to offer some suggestions. But let me be clear, I do not have all the answers. I'm just asking you to join me as we explore biblical, inspirational, and practical principles that have proven effective, and by God's grace, can help us reach our children and youth before it's too late, so that we can bring them to Jesus and help them to have a real, meaningful, and personal relationship with Him. And then to walk with them as they grow in that relationship, and one day together step into the eternal relationship as a part of the forever family of God. Our key text today is Matthew 19:14. But Jesus said, "Suffer, little children, and forbid them not to come unto me, for of such is the kingdom of heaven." Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for being such a loving Father. We thank you that we can come to you. Help us today as we come together and learn how we can help our children to also come to know you as the loving Father that you are. Open our hearts and our minds through the influence of the Holy Spirit so that we can learn what you want us to learn, and then give us the wisdom, courage, and perseverance we will need to undertake this solemn responsibility. We ask this all in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. As parents, and also as a church, one of the most important responsibilities we have is to disciple our children into a living, personal faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. The book of Proverbs makes it clear that the childhood years have a formative influence that lasts throughout their life. It says, train up a child in the way he should go. Even when he is old, he will not depart from it. The word here, to train, literally means to disciple, to dedicate yourself to your child. It's an action verb implying a concerted effort on the part of the individual doing the discipling. That's you. That's me. That's us as the family of God. I'd like to start out right away by addressing a couple of parenting issues that seem to prevail among us. One serious concern is what I believe to be a major misconception or perhaps misapplication of a significant aspect of discipling our children, and that is discipline. We know that discipling clearly does involve discipline. However, it's been my observation, and honestly, I was just as guilty of doing this myself. But many Christian parents seem to think that their role consists primarily of disciplining their children. Now, don't hear what I'm not saying. The Bible is clear that discipline is an important factor in Christian discipleship. You can read Hebrews 12:6 and Proverbs 13:24, and they make this clear. But discipline, the process of bringing the will into submission, is not enough. True discipling is an inside job. It's not just a matter of forcing outward conformity. It reminds me of a story Brother Suresh Kumar used to tell about a little boy who was being naughty, and he was made to sit in the corner as a punishment. After sitting there for a few minutes, he called out, "I'm sitting down on the outside, but I'm standing up on the inside." You get the picture, right? Still, so many parents, often without realizing it, are trying to drive or push their children to Jesus. And that is not the way Jesus wants us or our children to come to him. You see, Jesus called each of his disciples to follow him. He never forced them to come. In the same way, if we want our children to come to Jesus, then we have to lead them to Jesus. We have to encourage them to follow us as we follow him until they reach the point that they can follow him on their own. But we cannot coerce or force them into being Christ followers. In the book Adventist Home, we read, "While we are not to indulge blind affection, neither are we to manifest undue severity, children cannot be brought to the Lord by force. They can be led, but not driven." Jesus wants our children to come to him. He clearly said this, "Let the children come to me." But he wants them to come to him out of a love for who he is, and not because we are making them do it. Do you remember what Jesus said? "If I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men," or children, "unto me." This verse means that if Jesus is truly represented as the loving Savior that he is, then our kids can't help but be drawn to him. So if our children are not attracted to the Jesus we claim to serve, then perhaps we need to reconsider how we are representing him. Now, before we go deeper into this aspect of discipling our children, I'd like to briefly touch on another mistake we often make. And that is this assumption that if we simply provide our kids with a Christian environment, surround them with all the right influences, give them all the right information, then they're going to somehow automatically, almost like osmosis, adopt our beliefs and values. But this is not necessarily true. I mean, we bring them to Sabbath school and church. We homeschool or educate them in Christian schools. We ensure that their friends are from believing families. We take them to conferences and so on. All that's great. And it's not that it's not important. It is. However, discipling is much more involved than that. The church, a Christian environment, are there as a support to reinforce and affirm. But it's our job as parents to do the real discipling. Again, in Adventist Home, we're told, do not depend upon the teachers of the Sabbath school to do your work of training your children in the way they should go. The Sabbath school is a great blessing. It may help you in your work, but it can never take your place. In my opinion, you can replace Sabbath school with any of the other things we mentioned, and it's just as applicable. And further, we read, oh, that the youth and children would give their hearts to Christ. What an army might then be raised to win others to righteousness. But parents should not leave this work for the church to do alone. Providing a Christian environment and structure is simply not enough for the Christian nurturing of our children. The reality is, right now, we're seeing a high percentage of our young people who've been raised in the church, brought up in a Christian environment, but who do not continue in the faith. And it seems a lot of times we want to point our fingers at the church for not doing enough. And there may be some truth in that. But brothers and sisters, I believe a key factor is that many of us as parents just don't understand what it means to actually disciple our children in the faith. So let's talk about that. What do we mean by discipling our children? One Christian author put it like this. Discipling our children is the process of your children embracing the things of God as their own living faith, to see your children develop identities as persons under God. So if we want our children to come to Jesus, if we want them to embrace the things of God as their own, then we have to lead them. We need to guide them. And then allow them to make their own experiences with Him. That way, their faith will be their faith. They'll own it. They'll develop their own personal relationship and friendship with Jesus. Now, I mentioned earlier that in order to disciple our children, or anyone for that matter, we have to have a very close and meaningful relationship with them. This can only happen as your child is truly bonded in their relationship with you as their parent. It all begins with our relationship with our children. In all honesty, this is where a lot of us dads really seem to struggle and drop the ball. Moms are usually a little better at this than we are, just simply because women by nature tend to be more relational. Men have to work a little harder. So men, dads, are you hearing me? We need to work on this a little harder, if not a lot harder. Okay? I can hear in the background all the moms agreeing with me. I know this because I've talked with many mothers in our church over the years. And one of their major concerns is that their husbands often don't have good relationships with their children. And what's worse is that most of the men don't even realize it. So, like I said, guys, with God's help, we need to work harder at this. You know, I love how the book of Proverbs is written. It's basically written in the form of counsel from a father to a son. And Proverbs 23 is especially filled with this kind of language. Solomon writes, "My son, If your heart is wise, then my heart will be glad. Then he adds, listen to your father who gave you life, and do not despise your mother when she is old. But verse 26, in my opinion, really presents the very foundation or the core behind the wisdom of Proverbs. And it says, my son, give me your heart and let your eyes keep my ways. This is a powerful statement. The word I is used figuratively to represent the mental or spiritual condition of the person. So the writer makes it very clear that children will follow our ways only if they've given us their hearts. And if our heart is linked with God's heart, then their heart will eventually be also. So as parents, it's vital that we win their hearts first. So how are we going to do this? How are we going to foster this close relational bond that results in our children following in our ways, leading them to Jesus? Well, I would like to suggest four commitments designed to build a strong discipling relationship with your children. You only need to think of four easy to remember words: read, pray, work, play. That's it. Our first word is read. So parents, again, especially fathers, must read God's word to and with their children. Studies have indicated that people raised in strong Christian homes especially remember the influence of their dad's fervent and faithful ministry of reading, explaining, and discussing the scriptures with the family. In Romans 10:17, Paul states that faith comes by hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ. That means our children's faith will literally feed off the hearing of God's word from the mouths of their fathers and mothers. It's also important to help your children to learn the Bible stories and memorize Bible verses. Psalms 119:11 says, thy word have I hid in mine heart, that I might not sin against thee. This is one of the first Bible verses my grandmother had me memorize as a little boy. This one verse is filled with so much truth, but basically the idea is, if it's in their heart, it'll be in their head. And if it's in their head, it can be a powerful weapon against the enemy. Amen? Amen. Another thing that's very important is that everyday speech of parents in the home liberally includes the truth of God's word. Deuteronomy 6:7 tells us, teach them diligently unto thy children. Talk of them when thou sittest in thine house, and when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. That means all the time. Did you know that in one study where they asked spiritually strong Christian adults about the practices within their families that helped them grow up and retain their faith, one key element they mentioned was that there was a lot of what they called God talk. That's right, parents talked about God and Jesus as real individuals. And truthfully, that's the way it should be. In Adventist Home, it says that in the Christian home, his name is a household name. Folks, this is so important. Our children need to see our own devotion to God's word lived out in the home, experiencing firsthand from us the righteousness, peace, and joy that comes from the gospel. Because when discipling our children, religious instruction means that you are to show in your life that Jesus is everything to you, and that his love makes you patient, kind, forbearing. As the saying goes, if you're going to talk the talk, make sure you walk the walk. And of course, when it comes to the reading of God's word, there is no substitute for regular family worship. But most of you already know that, right? A time when the whole family gathers to study God's word and pray together. Spread out the word of God before your families in love and ask, "What hath God spoken?" In giving his word, our Heavenly Father did not overlook the children. In all that mortals have written, where can anything be found that has such a hold on the heart? Anything so well adapted to awaken the interest of little ones as the stories of the Bible. In these simple stories may be made plain the great principles of the law of God. Thus, by illustrations best suited to a children's comprehension, parents and teachers may begin very early to fulfill the Lord's injunction concerning his precepts. You shall teach them diligently to your children, and shall talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. It's also important to make family worship interesting. Be mindful of the education level of your children. Have time to discuss what you've read. And throughout the day, look for object lessons or opportunities to refer back to what you read. This will help reinforce the lesson and make it more personal and real for your child. Now, our second word is pray. In the book Home Missionary, we read, "If ever there was a time when every house should be a house of prayer, it is now." Keep in mind, that was written over 130 years ago. Do you think it's any less valid now? Parents, we must pray for and with our children. First and foremost, we should be prayer warriors for our kids. Not just bless my son or my daughter, but earnestly, specifically, and regularly beseeching the Lord on their behalf. Inspiration tells us it is impossible to estimate the power of a praying mother's influence. The power of a mother's prayers cannot be too highly estimated. Of course, this holds true for the prayers of fathers as well, right? Remember, the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. We as parents also need to pray for wisdom for ourselves on how to guide our kids on their journey of faith. In doing this, it's vitally important that we view our children as individuals and tailor our approach to their spiritual development according to what will work best for them. Remember, one size does not fit all. Seek to become acquainted with their various dispositions, that you may know how to train them in harmony with the Word of God. Another thing I'd like to add, pray out loud when you pray for your kids. That's right. Now, I'm not saying we should pray loudly to make sure that everybody hears us, but the fact is you never know when they might be listening to you pray for them, and that can leave a lasting impression. Believe it or not, a child's heart is warmed by the voice of her mother and father beseeching God's blessing and help on her behalf. In fact, there are countless stories of especially teenagers who simply hearing their parents praying for them changed the course of their life. As parents, we should also have regular times of prayer with our children, and should frequently pray with each one individually, one-on-one. You see, when we pray with them, we're modeling how we come to Jesus, and this teaches them how they can come to Jesus on their own. God has given to all fathers and mothers the responsibility of bringing their children to Jesus, teaching them how to pray and believe in the Word of God. You know what else is important? Parents should make sure that their children know they're praying for the specific challenges and trials that the child is facing. What this means is, in order to do that, we need to be aware of what's going on in their heart, in their minds, which is a major component of discipling in general. Some parents do not understand their children and are not really acquainted with them. There's often a great distance between parents and children. If the parents would enter more fully into the feelings of their children and draw out what is in their hearts, it would have a beneficial influence upon them. This requires active listening, really hearing what your child is actually saying. Whether we realize it or not, listening is perhaps one of the most important skills we as parents need to cultivate. And again, I hate to keep picking on dads, but we are usually really bad at this. Inspiration tells us parents should encourage their children to confide in them and unburden to them their heart griefs, their little daily annoyances and trials. So keep in mind, you can't know how to pray for your child if you don't cultivate a relationship where they tell you their struggles. And whatever you do, do not dismiss what might seem trivial to you. It's about them, their feelings, what's important to them. You see, if we dismiss or minimize something that is significant to them, then we just shut them down and actually destroy the likelihood that they'll ever confide in us again. Children would be saved from many evils if they would be more familiar with their parents. Parents should encourage in their children a disposition to be open and frank with them, to come to them with their difficulties, and when they are perplexed as to what course is right, to lay the matter just as they view it before the parents and ask their advice. And a little side note, if you're not cultivating this at an early age, then don't expect them to come to you when they're teenagers. It's very important to start practicing this early on while they're still very young. You know, I've told you that I made a lot of mistakes in how I raised my sons. But one thing I started early on that opened up my son's ability and willingness to communicate with me when they were very little, and even later into their teenage years and adulthood, that truly built a strong relationship with them, was every night I would go to them individually and ask if I had done anything that day to hurt or offend them. This helped me to know more of what was going on in their heads. And I can't tell you how revealing those conversations were. There were so many times that I would never have realized what I'd done or said or something to hurt their feelings if I hadn't done this. But these bedtime chats allowed them to share their feelings about their perception of an incident. It would also allow me to perhaps explain the whys of what I did or just apologize and let them know it was never my intention to hurt them. And that was so healing. Again, I had to be very careful not to always defend or justify my actions or dismiss how they perceived it. But this created a channel of communication that I still cherish with my sons to this day. Our third word is work. Working together with our children is very important. This means that as a parent, we should be involved, first of all, in their work. What do I mean by that? This is usually mainly schoolwork. We should be helping them and guiding them and taking an interest in whatever work they have to do. But it's also important that we invite our children to join us in our work and what we do. In Israel, industrial training was regarded as a duty. Every father was required to teach his sons some useful trade. The greatest men in Israel were trained to industrial pursuits. A knowledge of the duties pertaining to housewifery was considered essential for every woman, and skill in these duties was regarded as an honor to women of the highest station. Believe it or not, sharing work is a great way to build relationships. Work with them in the kitchen, work with them in the yard, work together painting walls, repairing furniture, whatever. It doesn't really matter what you do. Just do it, especially when they're young. Children love to work alongside their parents, and this process of growth and shared experience develops a strong bond. Now, again, a little side note for us type A parents, the perfectionists among us, you know who you are. And yes, I'm also one of them. There is a difference between expecting the best and accepting their best. And especially when working with young children, it's really more important to opt for the latter. It's crucial to encourage and not criticize. Yes, it's important to teach them to do a good job and do it correctly. However, more importantly, it should be about relationship. So ask yourself whether your response to their efforts will build or tear down the relationship. Another type of work that families should also engage in together is Christian service. Inspiration tells us, let parents and children work earnestly to help others. Those whom they help will be led by their example to help still others. Thus, the good work will deepen and broaden. This type of working together with your children is an invaluable life lesson. You see, they learn the joy of helping others and share in the Christian experience of self-sacrifice, which teaches them humility and kindness towards their fellow man. Now, our fourth and final word is play. Most parents and people in general truly underestimate the value of play and healthy recreation. First of all, play should involve our participation in their activities and what they enjoy. But it also allows us an opportunity to invite them to do things with us that we enjoy. Again, it builds relationships. When a dad gets down on his knees and builds Legos with his children or even colors together in a coloring book, their relationship bond is strengthened more than you might imagine. Or when mom goes outside and plays a game with the kids, this activity knits their hearts with hers in ways that nothing else will. Yes, I know that we're all very busy, but it's critical that we do this. Now, without a doubt, moms, you clearly bear the biggest burden with trying to maintain your household and raise your children. But please set some time aside in your day to play and just enjoy them. If you do this, guess what? I can tell you from experience, they'll be more eager to help with work and chores you need them to do later. This is not time wasted, but rather time well spent. And dads, I know most of you have the responsibility of working full time outside the home, but this makes it even more critical that you consciously take time to engage with your children in healthy, playful activities. Fathers, give some of your leisure hours to your children. Become acquainted with them. Associate with them in their work and in their sports, and win their confidence. Cultivate friendship with them, especially with your sons. In this way, you will be a strong influence for good. Now, I'm also aware there are a lot of other single parents out there, and you bear the burden of all the responsibilities. And that's a real challenge. Trust me, I get it. I raised all three of my sons as a single parent, and it's a tough row to hoe. But we also have to incorporate time for leisure activities with our kids. And for a single parent, that sometimes means letting some chores wait and just spend time with your kids. Trust me, it'll still be there waiting for you to do. But these special moments with your children will teach them how to be more balanced adults and leave them with memories they will cherish their whole lives. Another thing, don't forget to share your hobbies and recreational activities with your kids. I've always loved exploring nature, turning over rocks to see what's underneath, wading through creeks looking for crawdads, you name it. Almost every weekend when the weather was nice, my boys and I were out seeing what we could find. And you know what? My adult sons still enjoy doing this. In fact, it has always been an important connection that we share to this day. Even though my oldest sons live on a whole other continent, they will call me up to say, "Papa, guess what I found when I was out hiking today?" And I love it. The key to all this, of course, is healthy recreation or amusements. So when the weather permits, get outside. That way you're breathing fresh air and taking in sunshine. Here's another tip. Sometimes you can even turn work into play. Just get creative. You won't regret it, because all of this play has a very serious purpose: the bonding of your hearts in loving relationship through joyful shared experiences. So if our children are to come to Jesus, we need to lead them to Jesus. If we're going to lead them to Jesus, then we have to win their hearts to us first. And one way to do this might be to just remember the four words that I've mentioned today: read, pray, work, play. It's worth a try, right? Brothers and sisters, parents, I'm sure you've recognized the basic theme running through this whole study, because it can be summed up in one word: relationship. Our Heavenly Father is all about relationship. That's why He wants us to come to Him. That's why He wants our children to come to Him. The fatherly heart of God longs for an intimate relationship with all His children, young and old. As we read earlier, the Bible says, "My child, give me your heart." Jesus can say this to us because He's already given us His heart. You know the verse. We love Him. Why? Because He first loved us. Jesus shows us in everything He's done and continues to do that He loves us. It's the same with our children. If I want to win my child's heart, he needs to know that I have given my heart to him. But this type of true relationship building will always require time and effort, work time and play time, time in worship and time in service together. But it's during this time we spend with them, they'll see our hearts belong to them. And if we do this, then we will find our children's hearts eagerly offered back to us. And this is how we will lead them into the reality of our faith in Jesus Christ. This is how we can actively obey the call of Jesus to allow the children to come unto Him. I'll be honest with you. This is not an easy task. It requires work, a lot of work on our part. But remember, Psalms 103 tells us, The mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting upon them that fear him, and his righteousness unto children's children, to such as keep his covenant, and to those that remember his commandments to do them. And inspiration reminds us as well, the solemn work given to you to do can be neglected only at eternal loss. But the reward of faithful effort is greater than human minds can compute. Did you get that? So don't be discouraged. I know it's very easy to hear something like this and feel defeated before you ever even get started. But that's the enemy working on us. He starts whispering in your ear, what a mess you've made of things. It's too late now. Let me remind you of one more very simple truth. He's a liar. So don't buy into that lie. Take it one step at a time, one day at a time. Because just like how Jesus works with us, it all begins with love. Love begins with time. Time to come together. Time to communicate as a family. To come together and evaluate where you are and where you want to go. And never forget that all heaven is interested and invested in everything you're doing. You have a Father, a heavenly Father who wants more than anything to see you succeed. He wants your children in heaven. He wants you in heaven. And he's made every provision to get all of you there. He wants to work together with you, not against you. So let everything you do be done in godly love. And you know what? You not only can succeed, but you will succeed by God's grace, because you and your children can come to Jesus today. Amen.
Our God in heaven, we are so thankful, Lord, for keeping us safe here as we come to the end of the presentation. Be with each and every one of us. Guide us that we'll continue examining ourselves and that we should come close unto you. Lord, you know all our needs. You know all our desires. We wish that we should be counted among the saints. May your will be done. We pray. Amen.
Thank you everyone for spending this time with us. I hope that you have taken something of great value from the presentation shared. Unfortunately, we have come to the end of our online youth conference. May God bless you and keep you in a special way until we meet again. God bless.